Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Sing out. Let it.
Hallelujah. Welcome to the presence of the Almighty God today, trusting the Almighty God that He will respond to every love that we display for Him, because He has promised. He has promised. From that particular exhortation of yesterday, I want to encourage every one of us that you continuously show our love to Him in all areas of our lives. And our lives will never remain the same in the name of Jesus. So brethren, you're welcome to another wonderful moment in His presence. Today is Tuesday, the 7th day of November. And the topic we have today says, Seeing Jesus Purifies. Have a contact with Him, you have a relationship with Him. It purifies man. So, we just bow our heads to worship Him and we pray as we go into this exhortation of today. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. Heaven and earth adore. Even angels bow before Him. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. Heaven and earth adore. Even ages bow before Him. What a mighty God we serve. Father, we thank You for another opportunity to come before Your presence, to worship You, to adore You, to magnify You, to lift You high. You're worthy of our praises, worthy of our adoration, because there is none like unto You. Father Lord, thank You, because we're prepared to reciprocate every love that is shown to You. Father Lord, we thank You, because even as we know quite well that the harvest is always bigger than what is sown, so is Your love towards us will be far bigger than what You have given and we have given to You. We've seen it. Father, we are grateful that You did it in the life of Solomon. You did it in the life of Elisha. You did it, Lord, in the life of David. Father, we by this, O God, You help us to love You more in every area of our lives. Thank You, faithful Father. We appreciate You. Teach us again today. Impact our lives, O God. Lord, to see Jesus in the right that way. In Jesus' name, amen. Welcome, my brother and my sister. Seeing Jesus purifies. The memory verse for today is taken from Malachi chapter 3 and verse 3. Malachi chapter 3 and verse 3. It says, And he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. Look at this particular statement, that the Lord will be sitting as a refiner and as a purifier. That's our God, because He's a holy God. Anything unholy cannot come near Him at all. At all. And He says He will do this to the sons of Levi, that is, in the lineage of the priests, those who have made up their minds to serve the living God. Have you made up your mind to serve the living God? So it is that God wants us to be purified. To be purified. So from the above, you see that it is only the purified and the purged can offer offerings to God in righteousness. Only the purified. Anybody that is not purified, anybody that is not living a holy life, cannot offer in righteousness, because everything will be unholy. Whatever an unholy person touches, we become unholy. We become unholy. And we know quite well that when we talk about metals, gold and silver, purification to be refined is a process to make the metal shine. That every impurity in the metal will be burnt with fire. So God is saying that he wants everything about us to be purified. Any act of carnality or righteousness in us, they should be burnt off. Pray that the Almighty God will release a touch upon every one of us, that everything that will make our offerings unrighteous before the Almighty God, God will consume in our lives in the name of Jesus. It is coming before him in righteousness that makes our offerings acceptable before him. The Bible passage today is in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Check 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 15 to 18, I read. But even unto this day, where Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when he shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now, the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. From this passage, we see clearly that Jesus has come to beam his light upon our lives to open our spiritual eyes. Because that passage says that when Moses is read, the veil is still upon their heart. But when Jesus comes into one's life, our spiritual eyes will be opened, because he has come to take away the veils from us. He has come to take away the veil from our faces. Because in John chapter 8, verse 12, John 8, verse 12, the Bible says that, then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. When we follow him, there's no more darkness, no more covering upon our faces, because by the grace that brought us to salvation, the light of Christ will start to shine in our lives. It starts to shine. And also in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 6. 4 verse 6. It says, for God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. You can see, spiritual enlightenment through Christ. So that there be no veil covering our faces anymore. Spiritually, we'll be enlightened. So as we are seeing Jesus, becomes very crucial. Having an encounter with him becomes very crucial, because you need to be enlightened. You not walk in the old path anymore. Don't walk under the culture of man. Jesus has come to purify our lives. And the passage we read, verse 17, says, now the Lord is the Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Spiritual liberty comes to man when you have an encounter with Jesus Christ. Because in John 8, verse 32, John 8, verse 32, it says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. That truth is Jesus Christ. Because in John chapter 14, verse 6, John 14, verse 6, it says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So when you get to know this truth, there's no doubt about it. Spiritual liberty comes. It is the truth that sets free. The truth sets free. And there'll be liberty for you as we come to the Lord Jesus even today and surrender to him completely in the name of Jesus. Romans 8:2 says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus had made me free from the law of sin and death. The law of the Spirit of life. Law of the Spirit of life in Christ delivers man from the law of sin and death. So, brethren, you listening today, I plead with you, surrender your life to him, because God loves you and he wants to impact your life with that blessings of being able to live forever. So this experience will bring us to Christ likeness and spiritual progress, which is righteousness, when we surrender to him. When we surrender to him. From the body of this particular study of today, it says, when you see Jesus, everything blocking your vision will give way because it's the light. When light shines in darkness, darkness will find its level. So come to the Lord Jesus. Don't remain in darkness. At the time that they're now giving a testimony, at the time I came into ministry, we served God selflessly. There were no conditions given to it. Because you come into ministry by just saying, I love the Lord. You go all the way serving him. So nobody had to promise any of us a house, a car, or position, or title. No. Not serving God for a particular benefit. Physical benefit. No. Just serving him out of love. Say, I love this Jesus who died for me on the cross of Calvary. I'm really showing back my love to him for what he has done for me. We just loved God and we were ready to serve him no matter the cost. We were ready to take the shame and suffering that came along with our service. Those days, when you are an enlightened person, you are an educated person, you have a particular position, and you now say you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you look at you as something is already wrong with this fellow. How will somebody of your status say you are carrying the Bible all about? And we are called names. But those days, out of love, give everything to him. Furthermore, when we suffered, we did not grumble or complain because our focus was on Jesus. We were having challenges because those days, when you say you are a Christian, you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, in some families, there are reactions. Some people, their parents will come against them and say, we must not hear that one in this particular house anymore. If you try it, we will send you out of the family. And many were sent out, but they never regretted it because their focus was on the Lord. And this our God never in any way disappointed them. This is why our focus should also be today. This is where it should be today. Our focus should be in this particular, or this particular Lord, who will never disappoint. Who will never disappoint. When Joseph focused on the master and he was going through those hardships, he never shifted his focus and he ended up in destiny. That's a big lesson for us, never to shift our focus. Daniel never shifted his focus. And as a previous person, being one of the president in that nation of Babylon and a foreigner, anybody would have said, Daniel has made it. He's gotten to the top in that nation, one of the three presidents. When an avenue came, whereby they wanted him to shift his focus from the Lord, he said, no way. And that resulted in making him the only remaining president in that nation. I plead with you, never shift your focus from the Lord. In Mark chapter 10, 17 to 22, Mark 10, 17 to 22, it's the case of a young man who came to Jesus to find out what he needed to do in order to make heaven. The Bible says in this passage, he ran after Jesus Christ. And Jesus told him, do you know everything about the law? And he said, yes, I know. No adultery, no fornication, no, they mentioned a lot of things. And he said, yes, all this I've done. The Lord told him to go and sell all that he had and give to the poor, and then he should take up his cross and follow him. After that the statement, Jesus already knew what was next in his life that he needed to do in order to make it to heaven. So this was too much for him to bear. So he went away grieved. He thought he had met all the requirements, but the Lord told him what he lacked, which he never knew of. Brethren, the same way to you and I today, there's some things in our lives that we need to build up. Some things in our lives that we need to build up. Beloved, when you see Jesus, you will realize what is lacking in your life that you never thought about. When you meet with him and open up unto him, he will let you know areas that needs to be touched. And that is what we need so that we'll be able to make heaven. On our own, people might be praising you. You are good. You are that. You are that. Let us go back to Jesus. Examine me, Master. Show me the lapses of my life, the shortcomings, and be ready to make amends. Beloved, when you see Jesus, you realize what is lacking in your life that you need to bring to a correct situation. When you see Jesus, you will be able to see yourself more clearly and deeply. Jesus is the mirror through which you see yourself for who you really are. When you see him, your real person will be made known. For example, Saul of Tarsus was a religious, zealous person. And he was going all over the place to say, why are these people not following the teachings of the Sadducees and the Pharisees? Why are they carrying another teaching? A religious person. But on the way to Damascus, he met with Jesus Christ. In Acts chapter 9, 4 to 6, he met with Jesus Christ. And when Jesus told him what to do, and by the time we get to verses 20 to 22 of that same chapter, his life has changed. That zealousness was in a negative way. It was in a wrong direction. But when he met with Jesus, it was reordered. He started to do things the way God wants it done. Have you been zealous in a negative way? Check it with the Lord Jesus. Are you just religious? You've not heard about a salvation. Check with Jesus today. Jesus wants you to come. Have an experience. That zeal in Saul of Tarsus started being used in a positive way for the Lord. And he finished well. I pray for you. You will finish well in the name of Jesus. So in Isaiah 64 verse 6 says, but we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousness are as filthy rags, and we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. Every act of our righteousness, Bible says, just like filthy rags before him. That was what happened to Saul. He felt he was zealous for God. He was doing things for the religion. But on the long run, he met with Jesus and things changed for him. Things will change for you spiritually in the name of Jesus. It was after Isaiah saw the Lord that he realized he had been inviting God's judgment on himself as well as the people. He did not know that his lips, which he thought were anointed, were also unclean. Isaiah chapter 6, 1 to 7, said, after the death of King Uzziah, he saw the heavens opened. And it was then that divine illumination came to him. And he saw himself dirty. He saw the people surrounding him dirty. It is possible for somebody to be a prophet and yet be dirty. It is possible for somebody to say he carries an anointing and yet be dirty. He saw this. It was just the intervention of God. Divine visitation came for him so that he will have direction whereby he will live his life. He saw his true picture and he cried out to God for help. Are you in that situation today? We need to cry out to God for help. When you see the Lord, it will change your prayer point and you will begin to pray more appropriately. Isaiah cried for help and God sent an angel to touch his lips with a coal of fire from the altar to purify his lips. Malachi 3:2-3, as the memory verse that we read today, says the sons of Levi must be purified by fire. This is why servants of God should not be afraid of trials. Said sons of Levi must be purified by fire. Fire is not an easy thing. So servants of God must not be afraid of trials. When you go through very trying times, it is likely that God wants you to be purified. Likely that he wants you to be purified. So, any moment you are passing through something that is a challenge, better go on back to God and say, God, what are you trying to teach me? What are the things I need to learn? So that instead of just casting out demons, let God show what we need to learn from these particular experience. Isaiah 48 verse 10 says, behold, I have refined thee, but not with silver. I have chosen thee in the furnace of affliction. Chosen in the furnace of affliction. So, he wants to take out the debts and anything that will not allow you to fully manifest the grace of God that is upon your life. It takes you seeing Jesus to know how dirty or unclean you are, you really are. Seeing your true state through him will motivate you to call on him for help. Time of challenges, in order that we might be tested and be purified. So it's a time for us to cry unto God now. The key point says, looking at Jesus, the perfect eternal mirror, makes you see yourself in the realities of eternity. go, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Say, Father, grant me spiritual insight through the word. Talk to the Almighty God. Through your word of today and regularly, my Father, my God, grant me spiritual insight in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, let my spiritual eyes be opened. In the name of Jesus, illuminate my spirit man. In the name of Jesus, cry to Father and say, Father, I submit myself for purification and cleansing. I submit myself for purification and cleansing. Father, Lord, purify me. Cleanse me. Make me, my Father, my God, what you want me to be. In order that your blessings will rest upon my life. Let it be, O God. In Jesus' name we are praying. Mighty eternal Father, I want to appreciate you for today. Thank you for your word that I have sent to us, God. Father, you want us purified. You want us cleansed. My Father, my God, whatever situation that is purifying us now, my Lord and my God, I pray that you grant us the grace to be able to stand in that situation in the name of Jesus. Lord God Almighty, you helped Daniel. You helped Joseph. Father, help us to pass through our trying periods, Father, for purification in the name of Jesus, that none of us will be a loser at the end time, in Jesus' name. Thank you, faithful Father. In Jesus' name we are prayed. Join us as we sing this hymn, Deeper, Deeper. God bless you.
Sing out. Let it rain.